Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our service, Sunday the 19th of May. Yeah, we're heading in to the end of another month faster than we can think. But what a privilege it is to be with you this morning. I pray that God bless us and God speaks to us loudly and clearly this morning. Again, thank you for allowing me into your homes. Let's start with our call to worship this morning, taken from Psalm 104. Praise the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, as we gather this morning, we gather in one purpose, one mind, and that is to worship you, to honor you. How majestic is your name, your majesty, your power, your presence is just beyond us. So, Lord, thank you that we can come to worship you. Thank you for our side every week, Lord. Thank you for the technology to be able to share the message, where it goes, how it goes. I don't know, Lord, but you do. And I thank you for the lives that it changes. Thank you for allowing me to be the vessel. And, Lord, I just pray that this work, this word, this message bears much fruit, especially on this Pentecost Sunday. Lord, we also ask that you cleanse us and you wash us by the blood of the Lamb through the Son who came, died, and rose again to set us free. So, Lord, we thank you, we praise you, we pray that you'll open our hearts and minds that as we hear the scriptures, as we hear your message, that you speak loudly, clearly, and wonderfully to us this morning. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Two readings this morning, this Pentecost Sunday. The first is from Ezekiel chapter 37. The land of the Lord was upon me, the hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me to and fro among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? I said, O sovereign Lord, you alone know. Then he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make every breath enter you and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together. Bones to bone, I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe into the slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them, and they came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of those of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says. O my people, I'm going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from them, I will put my spirit in you and you will live. And you will know that I am the Lord. I have spoken. I have done it, declares the Lord. I might have seemed distracted, but I'm just blown away by that reading. It speaks so much to Pentecost. Our second reading is taken from Acts chapter 2 and verses 1 to 12. When the day of Pentecost came, They were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard them speaking in his own language. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Are not all these men who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Pigram, Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own language, in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Just that far this morning, and we ask that the Lord bless that reading to us. I'm distracted. Those readings, actually, I've prepared the sermon, I've done everything, but those readings have just spoken so loudly to me this morning, and maybe it's because it's Pentecost. Maybe it's just a reminder of the Holy Spirit and the wonder of the gift that the Lord Jesus left behind for us. So let me ask a question this morning. What do you think it means to be filled by the Holy Spirit? I don't know, maybe you can answer that question. Today, Pentecost Sunday, Holy Spirit Sunday, we remember that Jesus sent the disciples back to Jerusalem at the Ascension. He sent them back to go and to wait for the power on high. The work of the Holy Spirit starts today. A work that Jesus describes in John 15:26 as, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me." That's the start of the work. That's what the Holy Spirit's there for, to teach us about Jesus, to point us to Jesus, and Jesus points us to God. So with that being said, the question remains, what do you think it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit? In our reading from Acts verses 1 to 4, we read, "When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed like tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them." For me, for us, there's three elements here. Firstly, it's an event. Something happens. It's an event. Secondly, this Holy Spirit, the filling in the Holy Spirit, the presence of the Holy Spirit, whatever way you want to put it, is for all of us. And thirdly, out of that comes a response. So let's ask maybe another question. How can I know that I've been filled with the Holy Spirit? Well, if we continue in the theme that being filled with the Holy Spirit is an event, something happens, something tangible happens, it means that we can experience the Holy Spirit for the first time. We can feel something. Some say it's like being filled with an intense sense of peace and love. Others say it can be this inner knowing, this knowledge of being surrounded by light and peace and holy presence. There's no one way. There's no one way to feel the Holy Spirit. But it is certainly a profoundly moving and powerful experience for most people. To put it in a list, I guess we can say when the Holy Spirit enters one's life, one may feel a sense of peace, warmth, calmness, love, belongingness, acceptance, joy, hope, excitement, cleansing, purification, sanctification, protection, security, refuge, empowerment, motivation, inspiration, a deep sense of calling. indescribable knowing and understanding, a spiritual closeness with God. All of those are things that are tangible. We can know it, we can feel it, we can understand it. And speaking from personal experience and from experiences that have been shared with me over all the years, being filled with the Holy Spirit is real. It's tangible. It's life-changing. That being said, let's get to a harder question or thought. That idea that the Holy Spirit is for all. Simply, He is. The Holy Spirit has been around since the very beginning of time. Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the seas, over the waters. On a personal note, the Holy Spirit is within us from birth. That soft, still voice that points us to God, the picture found in Revelation 3:20. For I stand at the door and I knock. That Holy Spirit, tick, 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 tick. There's more, there's more, there's more. Go to God, come. And when we respond and open the door, God says, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. So the question, the thought of the Holy Spirit is for all, should be changed to, is the Holy Spirit active in me? So it's there. The Holy Spirit is there within us. But is it active within us? In truth, the Holy Spirit starts to move in power within us the minute we accept Christ Jesus as our Lord and our Savior and ask Him to come into our lives. When we allow the Holy Spirit to shape us and to mold us, when we move from death to life, that picture in Ezekiel 37 verse 5, this is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones, I will make breath into you and you will come to life. Verse 6 continues, I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know I am the Lord. That's the picture of the Holy Spirit work within us. That's the picture that challenges us when we read further in verse 11. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. We the church, sadly, Christians seem to be so dead and powerless. I mean, we seem to have lost hope. Our joy has been stolen. The prophetic word of 1 Peter 5, 8 and 9, be alert and sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour, is being manifest in the world today. We are being devoured. But now, today, Pentecost, is the time for us to stand up and resist him. Verse 9, standing firm in the faith because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of suffering. It's time for us to come alive. It's time for us to allow God through the Holy Spirit to breathe life into us. It's time for us to start bearing fruit, that fruit we've been speaking of the last couple of weeks. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Paul in that passage surrounding verse 22 says this, and he speaks of a life in the Spirit. He says, you, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge in the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love, for the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. It's what we're living. Just look at the world around us. So, I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, adultery, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, self-ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. It is so true. It is so prevalent around us. I warn you says Paul, as I did before, that those who live like this will not enter the kingdom of God. He then puts that famous verse in there, but the fruit of the Spirit is. And he continues after that by saying, those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying each other. That's the life we are called to. Go and read it. It's there for us to read. Galatians. We cannot live a life in the Spirit without opening ourselves up to receiving the Holy Spirit. God's only going to come in as far as we allow Him in. And if we want more, we want the power, we want the thing, we want the fruit, we want all of that, we've got to open ourselves to who God is. We cannot walk the walk and talk the talk without the Holy Spirit in our lives. We need the Holy Spirit to work in and through our lives, through revelation, by revealing and making known the presence of God, His Word. The aim is always for the Holy Spirit to reveal God and to glorify God. The Holy Spirit renews our minds, making us more Christ-like day by day. It's the journey we call sanctification, from holy to holy, glory to glory. The Holy Spirit helps us to understand the Scriptures. He calls us to work. Our response to God through the Holy Spirit, a response that is summed up in two very simple commands: love God and love one another. The Holy Spirit empowers us. Remember that verse, I think it's Ephesians, I can do all things. Well, that's the Holy Spirit within us. The Holy Spirit helps us to pray. In Romans 8, 26 and 27, we read, in the same way the Spirit helps us in our weakness, we do not know what we ought to pray, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And He who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. So He guides, He leads, He prays, He guides us, that great hymn, guide me, O thy great Redeemer, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but you are mighty. Hold me with your powerful hand, bread of heaven. Feed me now and evermore. Open up the crystal fountain where the healing waters flow. Let the fire and the cloudy pillar lead me all my journey through. Strong deliverer, ever be my strength and shield. That's the picture of our Holy Spirit-filled life. He empowers us. And last but not least, He provides the gifting. He gives us the skills, the ability, whatever you want, word you want to use, that we need to do the job that we've been called to. 1 Corinthians 12, 7-11. Now to each one the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one there is given the Spirit, a message of wisdom, to another message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by that one Spirit, to other miraculous powers, to other prophecy, to other distinguishing between the spirits, to another speaking in different kinds of tongues, and still to another the interpretation of tongues. All of these are the work of the one and the same Spirit, the Holy Spirit, and He distributes them to each one just as He determines. There's a lot of stuff here, but Pentecost is amazing. It is incredible when we allow that Holy Spirit into our lives. It's just, please just hear me today. It's not just today, it's not just Pentecost, it's all the time. We leak, we like sieves, so let the Holy Spirit fill us each and every morning. Pentecost, in conclusion, is much more than an annual event. It's a lifetime in God's presence. It's a lifetime of completed joy. It's a lifetime of fruit bearing. So instead of overlooking the Holy Spirit, this Pentecost, let us embrace Him and who He is as part of the Trinity and learn to better walk with Him. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, I don't know why we just the Holy Spirit, we sort of just incapacitate. Teach us today to just open ourselves to the wonder-working power of the Holy Spirit within us. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. Thank you that we are not alone. Thank you that you love us so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for joining us this morning. I pray that you've been truly, I love this. I mean, I started all wonky and freaky, battling to read, but I think it was just the wonder of the scriptures that I read. Please go and read them again. But just also know that God loves us, he has us, and he holds us in every moment and every way, and we are never alone. And so this morning I say, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, both now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace to love God's will. Amen.